Amen. Amen. Jesus Christ, the Anointed One. That's what Christ means. And remember that we are Christians. Perhaps we'll come to that a bit later this morning. David could only be who God wanted him to be because he was anointed. He could only fulfill God's purpose for him when he was anointed. Now, that was an outward symbol, but it was a powerful one, and it represented something much more. The story of Samuel and David was a time of great change for God's ancient people. It was a very significant time. The God's people had started off being led by the priesthood. But over time, and the priests remained a kind of leader of the people. Remember that when Jesus was tried centuries later, he was brought before the chief, the high priest, who remained a kind of leader, but the leadership of the priests had become inadequate for the nation, and they had not been faithful as they should have been. You might remember, if you're a Bible student, the sons of Eli, the last priest who was the ruler of the nation, the sons of Eli were corrupt men. And they did wicked things. They messed with the Lord's sacrifice. They messed with the Lord's people. And a new form of governance and leadership for the Lord's people became needed. And Samuel was the last judge of Israel. The judges had done what the priests couldn't for a while, but he was the last judge. And through his ministry, the kingdom emerged. But the leader of the Lord's people had to be anointed. It was always the case, if you go right back to when the nation was first formed by God, when he drew out a people from himself out of slavery and bondage in Egypt, and he made a people for himself. The leaders, at first, there wasn't to be a kingdom. They were to be a kingdom of priests, a nation of priests led by the high priest. And the priest had to be anointed. There are some lovely pictures which I can only point you towards to spend time dwelling upon, but no priest could function unless the crown and the consecration of the anointing oil was upon him. And when he was anointed, the anointing oil touched his ear. He had to be careful what he heard, touched his hand. He had to be careful what he touched, and it touched his feet. He had to be careful where he went. He was not able, the priest was not able to please himself in every way like others could. There were things he may not do. He had to be consecrated to the Lord. And nobody could function among God's people as God wanted unless they were anointed. There were one or two who tried to be priests who weren't anointed, and it ended very badly. There were one or two who tried to lead God's people without being anointed, but it ended very badly. Both priests and kings, and for that matter, prophets, were anointed. The prophets were not anointed with oil, but they were anointed by the Spirit. There's a psalm which says, "Don't touch my anointed. and do my prophets no harm. And the anointing oil that was used was precious and unique. It could not be imitated. It had a savor to it, an aroma that was unique in all Israel. And that's a lovely picture of the presence of the Spirit of God. It cannot be imitated. It's unique. When the Spirit comes, amen, the aroma fills and permeates everything. One of the words that anointing means is rubbed in. It gets into everything like a very high quality perfume. It seeps everywhere. The anointing, the presence of God's Spirit. Now that was all pictured for us outwardly in the anointing of the leader of God's people, Israel, at that time. But Jesus brought in a whole new arrangement. And remember, Jesus, some of the hymns we sing tell us he was prophet, priest. Anybody finish that off? Prophet, priest, and king. He was all of those things. And Jesus was and is the Christ. Amen, Mahiban. Prophet, priest, and king. He was always the Son of God. He was born the Son of God, but there came a point in his life where he was anointed for ministry, and that was when he was baptized in the Jordan. He was always the Son of God. He didn't become the Son of God when he was baptized in the River Jordan by John. He was the Son of God in himself. That was his nature and his person. But he was anointed for ministry. And let me read you a verse I wanted to read. And it's from Luke chapter 4 and verse 18. And in the Gospel of Luke, the first words Jesus uttered in his public ministry, this is as Luke records, the first words of Jesus' public ministry. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives. And you can read on what Jesus came to do for you and me, what he began to do when he walked in Israel, what he now is doing in human hearts everywhere, from the throne of God. Not that he worked, let's put it this way, I can't think of a better way to put it. He didn't work on his own. He didn't work of his own power. Let me read you another verse from John's Gospel about Jesus the Christ, the Lord's anointed. Jesus said about himself in John chapter 5 and verse 30. Jesus said, I can of myself do nothing. Wow. This is the Son of God on the earth, born among us. He said, I can of myself do nothing as I hear. Ah, just like the anointing on the priest way, way back in the old covenant. As I hear, I judge. And elsewhere, and Jesus said, I only do what I see the Father doing. His anointing was the source of his power, but he did not act alone. The Spirit of God dwelt on Jesus, and he worked and spoke as led by his Father. John actually says that after Jesus was baptized in the Jordan River, and there was the Spirit came on the Son of God in a new way. And John said this, it's in John chapter 1, verse 32. John bore witness saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and he remained upon him. From that day forward, the Spirit of God, the anointing of the Lord for Jesus' ministry, remained upon him, and Jesus remained, well, there's an old hymn that says, under the anointing, daily let me live. I've forgotten the hymn. I can remember the line from the hymn, but I can't remember the hymn. Under the anointing, let me live. Prof, somebody might remember it. And if you do, please put it on chat, because I can't remember the hymn. I think it was in Redemption Hymnal many years ago. Now, the anointing on David made him what he could not otherwise be. And the story of David is so important to the history of Israel, and it's so important to you and me if we are called Christians. That's what we're called, Christians. And that word Christian really specifically means anointed. Anointed. That's what it means. It probably wasn't used in that way. The disciples, we're told in the book of Acts, that the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch, when the Greek speaking believers had to leave Jerusalem after Stephen got stoned, and many of them went to Antioch, and a powerful church was founded in Antioch, and that's where the disciples were first called Christians. It was probably a bit of an insult. It was probably a bit of a what we call a nickname, not necessarily a nice name. You know that has anybody ever insulted you and called you a cretin? Have you ever been called a cretin? I hope you have never called somebody a cretin. Thank you, Tom. I was looking for that hymn. and you just put it on chat, and I'm going to write down it down before we finish this morning. Cretin comes from the French word for Christian, and it was an insult. It was an insult from the world, and the world is not always kind and pleasant. They think that you'd think, well, when I've been changed and I'm not the person I used to be, I'm not as unpleasant as I used to be, I'm not as dishonest as I used to be, you'd think the world would be glad of it. But they may not be. They might insult you. They might be rude to you. They might call you a cretin. But what a wonderful thing to be a Christian. And when you say, I'm a Christian person, what you're actually doing is saying, I'm anointed. I'm anointed. I'm anointed. Hymn number 691. Thanks, Tom. I'm going to check that out. Your memory's better than mine. An anointed person. That's what a Christian is. Wow. Now, remember, Jesus said, I can of myself do nothing. And Jesus also said about Christian people, let me read you John chapter 15, verse 5. Somebody might get there before me. John chapter 15 and verse 5. Now, you anointed person, you who have given your heart to the Lord, you whose heart has been cleansed and purified by the presence of the Spirit of God and an outpouring, because that's what oil does. Oil was used to cleanse, amongst other things, in those days when Jesus walked the earth. Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing. Amen. That which is flesh is flesh. God says, by pouring out my spirit, by cleansing your heart, by changing your heart, I can make you somebody who in your situation with the people you know can be, well, what somebody, what Oswald Chambers calls a unique addition of humanity, a unique person showing forth the praises of God. That's what an anointed person does. There's an aroma about an anointed person which somehow says the presence of God is in my heart and life. People won't necessarily thank you for it, but somebody will notice, somebody will see. And maybe if you walk under the anointing, as God has intended for you, somewhere, somebody's hunger for something they have not yet tasted will be woken up. And you might have to be faithful and speak the word of life to that person and tell them about what Jesus has done on the cross. But the first thing is, live anointed. David did. Saul didn't. Saul didn't live under the anointing. The Bible tells us that the king that Samuel first anointed, God gave him a new heart, but he didn't live under the anointing. David did. One of the remarkable things about David's life, you who are Bible students, was that he valued God's anointing more than anything else. There was a time, some of you will know the story, he had an opportunity to get back at Saul, who was persecuting him. He had an opportunity to he found him in a cave, and he could have killed him, but he didn't. He ripped off a bit of his garment. And they woke Saul up, and David showed him the garment, and then David felt terrible about what he'd done. And all he'd done was ripped Saul's garment, and David said, I should not have harmed the Lord's anointed. He valued God's anointing more than anything else in his life, and that's what made a little shepherd boy the king of all Israel. Listen, listen. You, Christian person, have an anointing. I should read a verse from 1 John, and I didn't write the verse down, and I should have done, but I know it's from the first letter to John, and it's chapter 2, and I think it's, is it verse 17, I think it is, 1 John, the first letter to John, and it's chapter 2, and it's verse 27. And John is writing to the churches and he says, the anointing which you have received from him abides in you. You don't need anyone teach you, but the same anointing teaches you concerning everything. We ought to learn from David that and it's not a picture or it's not a horn of olive oil mixed with spices. This is the presence of the Spirit of the living God, the Spirit of Christ in my heart and life. And I guess under the anointing, daily, let me live. The anointing that comes from the presence of God by his Spirit, you would be kind of on the right track if you were to say, I value that more than anything else in my whole life. That would be kind of getting on the right lines with God. I value his presence, the anointing of the Spirit. God's made me a priest. God has made every Christian person a priest in their own right. We don't need somebody in garments and vestments and fancy ceremonies. Martin Luther rediscovered that every Christian person is a priest. We're a whole kingdom of priests. What are priests? Anointed by the Lord, able to offer up spiritual sacrifices, able to speak from behalf of the Lord's words when we're called to do so. And David's life was full of ups and downs. David had his triumphs. David had his tragedies. David had his victories. And David had his catastrophes. But he always, always valued the anointing on his life. And when he made a real big mistake, you can read about it in Psalm 51, all he wanted to do was get back to the Lord and ask for his presence. We're using the picture of the anointing this morning. It's a biblical picture, his presence to fill his heart and life. Amen. Amen. I better draw to an end. I don't know if Billy is he's waving. That may be, but and if you don't feel too glad this morning, if you don't feel too full of joy, make no mistake. The presence of God is able to give you a gladness and a peace that the world cannot take away. Doesn't matter where you've been put or how you feel about your surroundings and circumstances. Jesus said, my peace I give to you, and the world's got nothing in me. I just want to read one final verse, and it's from Psalm 45, and it's verse 7. Well, just listen to this. Your throne, O God, I'm reading from verse 6, is forever and ever. The scepter of righteousness is the scepter of your kingdom. We've had pretty good ruler over our nation for the last few decades, but this is a throne which is forever and ever. You love righteousness and hate wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness. more than your companions. The oil of gladness. Amen. There's a joy that comes from walking with Jesus, which cannot be imitated, cannot be copied, cannot be matched. And it's all to do with the outpouring and presence of His Spirit in your life. Do you want to love righteousness, hate wickedness? Well, God, Christian person, God will anoint you with the oil of gladness and purify your heart. Amen. That's what you were made for. That's what you and I were made for. Sometimes it takes a lifetime for us to readjust to it. But the thing that you and I should value more than anything else in our lives is the anointing that is on every Christian person. That'll deal with your blues. That'll deal with your depression. That'll deal with your hurts. That'll deal with your sorrows. He's able to do it. Amen. Now, we're going to hear a song. The words of this song are lovely. It's an old hymn. Some people will know. Hail to the Lord's anointed. It's about Jesus. And we're going to hear it to a new tune. But if you can listen to the words of this song, it'll gladden your heart, because that's what God does. Amen. Mm-hmm.